morning I'm going to read from Psalm 107, verses 18, 19, and 20. The word says, "Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and He saved them from their distress. He sent forth His word and healed them. He rescued them from the grave." Amen. Brothers and sisters and friends and neighbors, God says, if we just call out to Him, cry out to Him in humility and be humble before Him and confess our sins, He will hear us and He will forgive us. We're all sinners and we're all need repentance in our lives. Would you pray with me this morning a prayer of repentance, a prayer for this service, a prayer for each other? Would you please humble yourself right now and lift up your heart and your voices with me as we go to the Lord in holy prayer? Let us pray. Father in heaven, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we humble ourselves before You. For we know, Lord, that You are God Almighty, Creator of all the heavens and the earth. You, Lord, everything that is, You have made. And You are holy and righteous, and we are sinners. We have failed You, Lord, and we have rebelled. But You, Lord, in Your love, in Your grace, You provided a way, and that way is Your Son, Jesus. He is the Christ. We believe that He became flesh and blood. You came and lived among us, and You died on the cross. You became our sin. You redeemed us, Lord. And You were raised in the power of the Holy Spirit. And that Spirit, Your Spirit, was within us. Please, Spirit, lead us and guide us, Almighty God. May we worship You in spirit. May we declare praises, Lord. And may we draw near to You. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, I lift up these people to You. Every soul in every family, asking You, Lord, to help us to humble ourselves before You as sinners. We ask for Your mercy, and we ask for Your grace, and we ask for Your forgiveness. Have mercy on us, Lord. Let us come to You now. Let us worship You in spirit. Lead us and guide us, Lord. Lord, we need to put away the world, not think about anything but You, to give You the glory. And we know we're weak. We know we can't do it without You. So, Lord, be with us. Be with each soul here. Everyone who hears this message, everyone who participates, may we all, Lord, come into Your presence and be pleasing to You. For it is in Your name, Lord Jesus, we do pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is our help and salvation. Are ye who now to His temple draw near, join me in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord who o'er all things so wondrously reigneth. Shelter thee under His wings, yea, so gently sustaineth. Hast thou not seen how thy desires ever have been granted in what He ordained? Praise to the Lord, oh, let all that is in me adore Him. All that hath life and breath, come now with praises before Him. Let the amen sound from His people again. Gladly for Him we adore Him. Amen. name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. You came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross. My debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Please stand with me this morning, and please, I ask of you to repeat after me, please. Jesus is Lord.
The Lord is good.
Praise the Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
The Lord is good.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. And please be seated. And as you're taking your seats, turn with me to the book of Joel this morning. Joel chapter 1, verses 1 through 12. Sister Smith will read for us in the Korean language. Sister Smith, please.
오늘 저희들에게 주신 하나님 말씀입니다. 요엘 1장 1절에서 12절입니다. 두부엘의 아들 요엘에게 임한 여호와의 말씀이라. 늙은 자들아, 너희는 이것을 들을지어다. 땅의 모든 주민들아, 너희는 귀를 기울일지어다. 너희의 날에나 너희 조상들의 날에 이런 일이 있었느냐? 너희는 이 일을 너희 자녀에게 말하고, 너희 자녀는 자기 자녀에게 말하고, 그 자녀는 후세에 말할 것이니라. 팥중이가 남긴 것을 메뚜기가 먹고, 메뚜기가 남긴 것을 느치가 먹고, 느치가 남긴 것을 황충이 먹었도다. 취하는 자들아, 너희는 깨어 울지어다. 포도주를 마시는 자들아, 너희는 울지어다. 이는 단 포도주가 너희 입에서 끊어졌으니 다른 한민족이 내 땅에 올라왔음이로다. 그들은 강하고 수가 많으며 그 이빨은 사자의 이빨 같고 그 어금니는 암사자의 어금니 같도다. 그들이 내 포도주를 멸하며 내 무화과를 끌고 말갛게 벗겨서 버리니 그 모든 가지가 하얗게 되었도다. 너희는 처녀가 어렸을 때에 약혼한 남자로 말미암아 굶은 배로 동이고 애곡함 같이 할지어다. 소제와 전제가 여호와의 성전에서 끊어졌고 여호와께 수종드는 제사장은 슬퍼하도다. 밭이 황무하고 토지가 마르니 곡식이 떨어지며 새 포도주가 말랐고 기름이 다하였도다. 농부들아, 너희는 부끄러워할지어다. 포도원을 가꾸는 자들아, 곡할지어다. 이는 내 밀과 보리 때문이라. 밭의 소산이 다 없어졌음이로다. 포도나무가 시들었고 무화과가 말랐으며 석류나무와 대추나무와 사과나무와 밭의 모든 나무가 다 시들었으니 이러므로 사람의 즐거움이 말랐도다. 아멘.
Amen. Joel chapter 1 verses 1-12. The word of the Lord that came to Joel son of Pethiel. Hear this, you elders. Listen, all who live in the land. Has anything like this ever happened in your days or in the days of your forefathers? Tell it to your children, and let your children tell it to their children, and their children to the next generation. What the locust swarm has left, the great locusts have eaten. What the great locusts have left, the young locusts have eaten. And what the young locusts have left, other locusts have eaten. Wake up, you drunkards, and weep. Wail, all you drinkers of wine. Wail because of the new wine, for it has been snatched from your lips. A nation has invaded my land, powerful and without number. It has the teeth of a lion, the fangs of a lioness. It has laid waste my vines and ruined my fig trees. It has stripped off their bark and thrown it away, leaving their branches white. Mourn like a virgin in sackcloth, grieving for the husband of her youth. Grain offerings and drink offerings are cut off from the house of the Lord. The priests are in mourning, those who minister before the Lord. The fields are ruined, the ground is dried up. The grain is destroyed, the new wine is dried up, the oil fails. Despair, you farmers, wail, you vine growers, grieve for the wheat and the barley, because the harvest of the field is destroyed. The vine is dried up and the fig tree is withered. The pomegranate, the palm, and the apple tree, all the trees of the field are dried up. Surely, the joy of mankind is withered away. May the Lord add blessing to the reading of His holy word. Let us pray, please. Our Father in heaven, thank you. Thank you for this word. Thank you for this message. And Thank you for these people and all those who hear it, Lord, who receive it. May they receive it in their heart of hearts. May, Lord, we all have your understanding, your eyes, ears that only you can give us, that we may draw near to you through this message. Lord, it's all about you, Lord Jesus. You are our Savior, and it's in your name, Lord Jesus, we do pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. Modern events. Today we start the book of Joel. Please keep your Bibles open to Joel chapter 1 because we will read the rest of it. You know, I think today that a wise person who pays attention to events in this world is a wise person. You need to pay attention to the events. Now, I know that generally speaking, the news is not good. And I know sometimes it's hard to sort of strain out what you need to listen to and what is just somebody else's idea of what happened. And I know that there's false information, but we need to be aware of today's events, modern events. We need to know today what's going on. Because if we know modern events, if we know world events and circumstances that surround us and are around us or in this world, then maybe we can understand just a little bit, have a little bit of an understanding of where we are in time. Where we are in time. And maybe we even can have an understanding of why things are happening the way they are. Jesus said this in Matthew 16, 2 and through 4, Matthew, Jesus said this. He says, when evening comes, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, today, it will be stormy, for the sky is red and overcast. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the signs of the times. A wicked an adulterous generation looks for a sign, but none will be given it except the sign of Jonah. You know, time marches on, no matter what we do to try to stop it, and things are happening all around us. You can do all you can to stay young and look young and think young and all everything is possible, humanly possible and even more, but still, things are happening and you get older. We all do. And if you're older than probably, let's say, 26 years old, probably one of the most or the most devastating national event that you have experienced is the attack on our nation on September the 11th, 2001. You probably, if you were old enough, you probably remember exactly where you were when you heard about the attack on the United States. You probably remember exactly where you were. You know, I know exactly where I was. I was in my office here in Madison at Victoria Drive over here. I had an office there working in my office, and that's exactly where I was. I was there, and that's when I heard the news. Actually, someone called me and told me what was going on, so I went and turned the TV on. But I had to quickly, after I saw what it was all about, I had to quickly go back into my office and finish a document that I was working on. And at those days, I was a contractor, and I was working on a document, and I had to finish that document that day. So I quickly finished it, and after I finished that, then I went to the TV, and I was glued to that TV the whole rest of the day trying to find out what happened. I actually remember watching those towers fall on TV and what horrible thoughts was going through my mind. And I had friends that were actually TDY that worked in the same office I did that was there visiting the Pentagon when it was attacked. And they couldn't even get a rent. They couldn't fly back. As y'all remember, the planes were stopped flying. They couldn't fly back. They were stuck there. They tried to get a rental car. I told them, get a rental car. Everybody else was trying to get rental cars too. Couldn't get a rental car. You know what they came back in? There were six of them. They rented three U-Haul trucks, 24-foot vans. That's all they could get. And they came back in those empty trucks because they needed to come home. They needed to come home to feel safe. You know, that attack, that affected the U.S. greatly, that one event. Those of you that are my age or maybe even a little younger, remember the stock market failed. It had one of its biggest losses that it ever had in history in one day. Security became so important after that attack. Flying was not fun anymore for me after that event. In fact, I hate flying today, and it's all because of the 9/11 attack. Of course, there were some others that added to it, the people who were trying to kill us, Americans. You know, the people here in our scripture in Joel's day had just experienced a devastating attack also, an attack from locusts. So God led Joel, or called Joel, to use that event as a backdrop of his message to the people. You know, if there'd been newspapers in the prophet's day, in Joel's day, the headline might have read in bold capital letters, "Locusts invade the land." And then slightly smaller capital print, "Nation faces severe economic crisis." And finally, a third heading, still in large print, "No end to the drought in sight." I think that Joel chapter 1 teaches us to pay attention to what God is saying to us through our present world events. What is God trying to tell us? What's going on? Why is it happening? Let's look at our text and see if we can get a little bit of wisdom or glean something from it. First, Joel is called. Let's look at the call here to the prophet. We read in Joel 1:1, "The word of the Lord came to Joel, son of Pethiel." Now, there's about 12 men in the Bible by the name of Joel in the Old Testament. We know nothing about our just Joel right here, except that we learn about him in his book. We don't know anything else about him. We know that Joel means Jehovah is God. Joel was the son of Pethiel. Joel was perhaps probably one of the earliest of the Old Testament prophets that was writing in our Bible. Joel probably lived or in or near Jerusalem. And we can assume that Joel probably prophesied in Jerusalem. Now, scholars, Bible scholars, theologians, they differ widely over the date of his prophecy. Maybe the reason Joel did not give us many details or about himself was sort of to keep his readers' attention, their focus on his message and not on him. Maybe that's what he was thinking. They don't need to know anything about me. They just need to know the message. They just need to know what God is saying. Moreover, and most important here, Joel stresses that the word of the Lord came to him. The word of the Lord came to him. No true prophet of the Lord ever creates by himself the divine word that he delivers. God's word came by God, divine initiative. It's his word. And as a consequence, I want us to think about this morning, even though it's a small book, the consequence is this word must be heard with the same awe that we demonstrate by it, that Israel demonstrate. Remember at the At the Mount Sinai, and God was on it, and the thunder and the lightning and the trembling. The people were afraid, weren't they? They were afraid. We should have that same feeling toward the Word of God. Whether this message appeals to us personally or not, it must be accepted as God's Word and not man's Word, simply because he said the Word of the Lord that came to Joel. Then we have a call to the nation. Let's think about this call to the nation. The occasion for Joel's message was a massive and devastating invasion of locusts. Now, y'all realize where the United States of America is so big compared to little Israel that we don't really take locusts very serious. Now, if you lived out in the Midwest, and you grow grain or wheat or whatever, you'd probably be worried about locusts. But here in Hunts Patch, Alabama, we don't think much about locusts, do we? But it was devastating to farmers and people of those days. They had to have the grain to live. So this was a great devastation of locusts, and Joel began first by addressing the elders. And probably he addressed the elders for two reasons. First, they were respected citizens in the land. There was a day that here in the United States, we were taught to respect our what? Our elders. That seems to have gone away nowadays. But there was a time I was taught to respect my elders. Whether I liked them or not, I should respect them. Whether they were nice or not, I should respect them. They didn't have to be good to me for me to respect them. So they're respected people. And second, because they were probably elders, they were old, they had lived a long time, and they could basically say yes or no to what Joel was saying in regards to what had happened. They had experience that the young people didn't have. And with their support, he wasn't just a lone voice. If they would support him, he wasn't just a lone voice crying in the wilderness. And they would probably agree with Joel about the severity of this devastation that had come upon them. They would affirm that the nation of Israel faced a catastrophic event of monumental proportions. Jesus said Joel said in verses 2 and 3, "Hear this, you elders. Listen, all who live in the land. Has anything like this ever happened in your days or in the days of your ancestors? Tell it to your children, and let your children tell it to their children, and their children to the next generation." Then Joel went on in verse 4 to describe how severe the devastation was. What the locust swarm left, the great locusts have eaten. What the great locusts have left, the young locusts have eaten. And what the young locusts have left, other locusts have eaten. Now, I got to tell you, it's not very clear here to me or anybody else, and I've looked at several commentaries. It's pretty unclear what Joel meant by describing four different kinds of locusts. Some think it represents the four different stages of the life of a locust. Others think it represents four different kinds of locusts. But it doesn't really matter. You know what really matters? The point is clear. There was locust, 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 and more locust. Which means it was devastating. There was a massive locust invasion of the land. The devastation caused by the locust was extremely severe. Everything was gone. the devastation was so sorrowful that there would probably be a great famine. No people, everybody would go hungry. Nobody would have anything. What is so remarkable, I think, here about Joel's description of the severity of the devastation caused by the locusts is how he himself, how he dealt with it. And I think we can learn from that, how did he deal with it? He didn't minimize the severity of the devastation. He did not treat this catastrophe lightly. He understood that something terrible had struck the people of God. And he wanted the people to understand what had actually happened and how bad it was. So he called on various groups of people. Various groups in the land to mourn with him. The first group Joel appeared to were the drunkards. Now, I want you to know that when I read that, I thought to myself, what? Why is he talking to the drunkards first? Joel said in verse 5, he says, "Wake up, you drunkards, and weep. Wail, all you drinkers of wine. Wail because of the new wine, for it has been snatched from your lips." And I thought to myself, wow, that's interesting that he would call on them first. What's going on here? Now, if you read more of Joel and you read forward and do a little study, and it's very interesting because in addition to pointing out the insincerity of some of the worshipers later in Joel 2, he's going to talk about the insincere worshipers. Drunkenness, getting drunk, is the only sin that Joel mentions in his whole book, except for the insincere worship. It's only two sins that he mentions. Is that not interesting? He's calling on the drunkards, and that was the only sin other than the insincere worship. Maybe drunkenness represented all the careless people in the land who had one primary interest. And you know what that primary interest was? Self-indulgence. Self-indulgence. You can be drunk and not be drunk on wine. You're drunk because alcohol affects you, right? But what do you call drunk when events in the world cause you to do things that you normally wouldn't do? Or maybe the love of money or too much money causes you to do. Would you be drunk? Would you be affected by other things in the world just like alcohol? Maybe not exactly the same, but things of the world certainly make us do things that we normally wouldn't do. That's what alcohol does to us. Is that not true? Then Joel appealed to the whole nation. The people were to mourn like a virgin in sackcloth, grieving for the betrothed of her youth. In other words, instead of a young bride getting ready for her wedding, her groom died. So she exchanges the beauty of a wedding dress for a coarse sackcloth clothing. And the reason is that the locusts have killed everything that will enable the nation to bring worship offerings to the Lord, as Joel said in verses 9 through 10. Grain offerings and drink offerings are cut off from the house of the Lord. The priests are in mourning, those who minister before the Lord. The fields are ruined. The ground is dried up. The grain is destroyed. The new wine is dried up. The olive tree fails. Next, Joel appealed to the farmers. He said in verses 11 through 12, he says, "Despair, you farmers. Wail, you vine growers, grieve for the wheat and the barley, because the harvest of the field is destroyed. The vine is dried up, and the fig tree is withered. The pomegranate, the palm, and the apple tree, all the trees of the field are dried up. surely the people's joy is withered away. Think about this for a second. There was no Kroger to go to down the road or Publix or anything else. The farmers around there, that's where they got their food from. They had to have all that. They had to have the fruit. They had to have the grain to live, to survive. And not only that, they couldn't even give anything to God because they had nothing. The gladness and the joy that should have characterized God's people was gone. Joel called the nation to sorrow and mourn with him over the devastation that had been caused by this locust plague. And he wanted people to understand what God was saying to them through that natural disaster. He wanted them to understand, why did God allow this to happen? Today, people all over the world experience natural disasters and earthquakes and droughts and famines and floods and epidemics and so on and so on. All over the world, people suffer that. Even for ourselves, even you and I, we experience what I'll call personal disasters, don't we? Personal disasters, the death of a loved one, maybe financial setbacks, maybe we lose our job, maybe relationships fail, whether it's our fault or somebody else's fault, our relationships, we have trouble with relationships, don't we? Humans want relationships, and yet we have so much trouble from our relationships, and many times we are the maker of the problem. Health breakdowns, accidents, we lose our health, we have accidents. So many different types of things can happen to us. Our lives are fragile, and I'm not talking about life itself, I'm talking about our lives as we live. They're so fragile. All it takes is for you to be going home and a car hits you in the side as you're going through an intersection. And there goes our life. Oh, you may live, but what kind of life may you have after something like that? Crippled, unable to walk, paralyzed for life. So many things. Don't have insurance. The guy that hit me didn't have insurance. In all the issues that come our way, Joel is asking us to say, what is God saying to us? Now remember, all these things I mentioned can happen to each and every one of us. No matter how well you think you have planned, no matter how much you have saved, no matter how much strong you are, how much you're educated, there are so many different things that can happen to us at the blink of an eye, very quickly, and it could devastate our lives. What is God saying to us? That's what Joel wants us to think about. When these things happen, whether it's great or small, whether the small things, the bad things, the things that make us worry, the things that make us hurt, the things that change our lives, what is God saying to us? Joel wrote his book so that people would know what God was saying through those events. Now let's read the rest of Joel chapter 1. Look at Joel 1, 13 through 20 and follow along as I read. We're finishing the chapter. Joel 1, 13 through 20. Follow along as I read. Put on sackcloth, O priests, and mourn. Wail, you who minister before the altar. Come, spend the night in sackcloth, you who minister before my God. For the grain offerings and the drink offerings are withheld from the house of your God. Declare a holy fast. Call a sacred assembly. Summon the elders and all who live in the land to the house of the Lord your God and cry out to the Lord. Alas, for that day, for the day of the Lord is near. It will come like destruction from the Almighty. Has not the food been cut off before our very eyes? Joy and gladness from the house of our God. The seeds are shriveled beneath the clods. The storehouses are in ruins. The granaries have become broken down, for the grain has dried up. How the cattle moan. The herds mill around because they have no pasture. Even the flocks of sheep are suffering. To you, O Lord, I call. To you, O Lord, I call. For fire has devoured the open pastures, and flames have burned up all the trees of the field. Even the wild animals pant for you. The streams of water have dried up, and fire has devoured the open pastures. Amen. May the Lord add blessing to the reading of His holy word. Priests and ministers, did you see at the beginning who He's talking to? Notice here the need for repentance. Joel called the ministers to lead in repentance. He said in verse 13a, he says, put on sackcloth, you priests, and mourn. Wail, you who minister before the altar. Now, the reason for the need for repentance was not just that there was no food because of the locusts. It was because God's worship was affected by this disaster. You ever think about that? Think about this for a second. Those of you who tithe, if you lose your job, will you continue to tithe? You don't have money. The tithe is 10% of what God gave you. If you don't have the money, do you tithe? You don't tithe because you didn't make any money. You don't have any food, you don't have any grain, you can't give a tenth of your grain because you don't have any grain. You see, this affected everything, God's worship. And Joel continued in verse 13b, he says, for the grain offerings and drink offerings are withheld from the house of your God. When God's judgment falls on God's people, God's ministers should take the lead in repenting before the Lord. I should always be the first one to humble myself before God and repent of my sin. And if I let you repent before I do, then I have failed you and I have failed God. At the same time that I repent and pray, ministers must call people of God to repent as well. Brothers and sisters, I know I talk to you a lot about repenting, but I don't call you to do it any more than I repent myself. In fact, I hope that you're repenting as much as I am and is humble. I know I'm not what I should be, but I'm called as a minister to lead you to repentance, because through repentance you receive salvation. Joel tells the ministers in verse 14 to declare a holy fast and call a sacred assembly. Summon the elders and all who live in the land to the house of the Lord your God and cry out to the Lord. God's ministers sometimes call congregations to pray and to repent of their sins. So Joel here, he issued a call to ministers to lead in repentance. However, as the children of God, I want you to understand something. We are Christians, and Christians do not live in fear of God. I want you to understand that. We are God's children. We are Christians, and we want to please God. But we don't live in fear. A child who has loving parents, they don't live in fear of their parents. And even though they know they're going to get a whipping if they do something wrong, even though they may get punishment if they do something wrong, they still know that their parents love them. A child is secure because it knows that their parents love them even though they're being punished. Because if parents did not punish their children, they punish them because they love them and they want them to learn. And they want to teach them. They want to help them. When God's people go through difficulty and disaster, they have hope. We go through disasters. We go through problems in our lives, don't we? We have situations. We lose our health. We have operations. We struggle. But we have hope. If God is calling us to repent, that must mean that He's willing to accept us if we repent. Right? Why would God call me to repent if He's not there to accept me when I do repent? God delights in receiving those who ask for forgiveness. He loves saving a sinner. He loves forgiving us. Joel states that the main theme of his prophecy in verse 15, this is his main theme. He says, "Alas, for that day, the day of the Lord is near, and it will come like destruction from the Almighty." Joel talks about the day of the Lord. In one sense, every day is the Lord's day, isn't it? In some ways. The day of the Lord is a theme that's repeated throughout the whole Old Testament. The day of the Lord may be defined as this. The time. A day is coming. The time that God will intervene. He will intervene to punish the wicked. And He will deliver and exalt His faithful people who worship Him and establish His own rule. When He comes, when the Lord comes back, the day of the Lord that we're looking forward to, the one that they were singing about in the choir, all that, when that trumpet calls, that's going to be what a day that's going to be. That's the Lord's day. And Joel's point here is that this event of the locust was intended to cause the people of God to know that a future day of the Lord is near. This event should cause the people to repent and return to the Lord because a day is coming when it will be too late to return. It'll be too late to return to God. It'll be too late to repent because the day of the Lord has come. The next thing is a prayer. In verses 19 and 20, Joel himself led the people in prayer. He was not outside the Lord's judgment and salvation. Remember, the rain rains on the righteous and the wicked. Remember, Joel was dependent on that same grain, that same wheat, the same everything else that the other people were. And Joel was suffering just like the rest of the people. He prayed. He prayed for the people. He even prayed for the beast of the field, didn't he? Because of this locust infestation. So he was praying for himself. He was praying for the people. He was praying for the beast of the field. He was suffering just like everybody else. He prayed in verse 19 through 20. He says, "To you, Lord, I call, for fire has devoured the pastures in the wilderness, and flame has burnt up all the trees of the field. Even the wild animals pant for you. The streams of water have dried up, and fire has devoured the pastures in the wilderness." He was praying, calling out to God. Prophet of God. In conclusion, on one occasion, you may remember this, Jesus was asked about a human disaster against some of the Galileans who, when they were worshiping. Y'all remember that? The Galileans, they were worshiping, and Pilate had some of his soldiers come in, and he killed these worshipers, these Galilean worshipers, and then he took their blood and he mingled it with the blood of their sacrifices on the altar. Y'all remember that? How could God allow such a thing to happen? Worshipers worshiping God before the altar, killed in their blood, mixed with the blood of their sacrifice. And how could he let it happen when his people were there worshiping him? And Jesus was also asked about a natural disaster when the Tower of Siloam fell and killed 18 innocent bystanders. 18 people died when that tower fell on them. How could that be? How could God let these happen? Were these 18 more sinful than others, so they deserve to be struck down, killed by that fallen tower? Did they deserve it? Jesus said in Luke 13, 2 through 5, he says, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all other Galileans because they suffered this way? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish." Or those 18 who died when the Tower of Siloam fell on them. Do you think they were more guilty than all the others living in Jerusalem? He said, "I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish." Jesus is saying this. I want to paraphrase what he's saying. He's saying to those who object to those tragedies, who object, just like the locust plague or 9/11 that we experienced, or any other accident in our lives, or cancer diagnosis, or bad health, or a relationship broken families with trouble between kids and parents and husbands and wives, just the same thing. When they ask the wrong question, when they say, "Lord, why did you let this happen? Why did you, God Almighty, let am I worse than others? Why did you let this happen?" They ask, why should disaster fall upon these people? They're asking the wrong question. They're asking the wrong question. Why should God strike these innocent people? That's the wrong question too. But they should be asking this: why hasn't these disasters fallen on me? Why haven't they destroyed us? You see, our problem is this: we easily forget how sinful we are. How come we didn't die like those who died in 9/11? How come we didn't die during the pandemic? How come tornadoes didn't hit my house or your house? I'm just as guilty, as maybe more guilty than the people who suffered. Aren't you? That's what we got to think about. And brothers and sisters, listen. If you're going through a difficult time right now, maybe you've lost your health or a loved one or something in your life is just difficult. It's difficult. And you're probably thinking, I'm having a really bad disaster. It's really bad right now. Look at it this way. God is calling you to repent and return to Him in total dependence. Think about it that way. Don't try to blame God for letting it happen. I bet if you look at your disaster, unless it's a natural disaster, I bet if you look at it, it's probably you had a great deal to do with it yourself. You might have even caused it. And yet, how quickly we blame God and feel sorry for ourselves. What's God trying to tell me? What's God trying to tell you? Think about that. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, oh Lord, have mercy on us. Oh Lord, forgive us, for we are a sinful people and we live in a sinful world. Lord, disasters and plagues and trouble is all around us. We have trouble. We experience things in our lives, Lord, that we wish were not there. And we say, Lord, why? Why are you letting these things happen? Lord, we are guilty and we deserve everything that could happen. Let us think about that, Lord. Let us think about what you are trying to tell us through these disasters. What are you trying to tell us through all these things that are happening, Lord? We deserve it all and much more. Please, Lord, let us repent and return to you as a people, and not only as a people, but personally, our personal lives, Lord. Let us humble ourselves before you, because you are God Almighty. And Lord, if there's someone here today that they need to know you, Lord Jesus, as their Lord and Savior, let them come with a broken, contrite heart to you. And Lord, may you hear us and forgive us. For it's in your name, Lord Jesus, we do pray. Amen. Let's all stand.